boys and girls. I have been asked to speak on inspiring students and serving society while being in professional services like government service. Now, for many people, doing social service is a very inspirational thing. Across the country, in whichever profession you are, if you want to do some social service, actually it inspires you in your day-to-day life. But for a government servant, he is called as a public servant. In fact, you will see Union Public Service, Telangana Public Service Commission. The very fact is that every government servant is a public servant. So every day the work he does is only a social service, of course, for which he gets paid substantially. So I am given just 10 minutes time. I would like to speak for about 7 minutes on what a government servant should be like, and maybe I will speak for about 3 minutes on what social service being a government servant we can continue to do. First and foremost, being in government service, you should recognize that your entry into the government service itself should be clean and transparent. Why? I am occupying a very important chair. That is just because the system was clean. Many of you may be aspiring to get into the civil services. Some of you may be aspiring also to get into the engineering services and to various government departments. First and foremost, you should understand is that you are getting a job in the government because the system has been clean. I am a beneficiary of that system because the agency which conducted the examination and the recruitment process, the UPSC, has a very clean system, has maintained an excellent track record for the last 50 years. So it is our bounden duty to keep the system clean. Every piece of work which we do is actually a public service or a social service. If you have good people in good places who are supposed to lead the government or lead the public service, that itself is a big social service. So your entry should be clean and transparent. Then you should understand your working environment. Lot of people have confusion about the role which they are supposed to play in the organization. You may join at any level, but you have a defined role to play. First, you should understand the role for which you have been recruited. Whether you are a police, you are a government doctor, or you are a IRS officer, or you are IRS officer, or for that matter, you are a judge. You have a role to play, and please understand first the role which you are expected to play. Then there is something which is very, very important, which I want even as students you should understand. There is dharma for every activity. What is dharma? See, when you start doing a work, you don't do for any purpose. You do for a larger purpose. This is what I keep telling in my office to all my staff. Even as students, you should understand. You don't study for your lecturer, you don't study for your professor, you don't study for your parents. You have to study it for yourself. You have a duty as a student. Similarly, you will have a duty as a public servant. Please do the duty which is ordained for you, and in the spirit that nobody need to watch you. If you are a good student, in my opinion, one who is a good student is one who knows how to spend his free time. I can see many students preparing very hard for an exam. One day before exam, they are studying for almost 16 hours, 18 hours. That is no great issue, because most of the people will study because tomorrow is an exam, so you will be studying for today. The hallmark of a good student is one who knows how to spend his free time, how to make use of it, and how to put it to best possible use. Similarly, for a public servant, you should do the duty irrespective of whether your boss is there, somebody is watching or not. So this comes from a deep-rooted understanding of the scriptures and also the moral values which you cherish. You start doing the work irrespective of whether anybody is watching or not, and you will do it in a correct manner. Then one big problem we face with the public servants is they have developed a totally negative attitude. Most of the public servants have developed a negative attitude. The negative attitude is whenever you go with a problem, they always say that this is not possible to do. Somehow the attitude throughout has been that how not to do a work and to invent the reasons why you cannot do it. See, if you join the public service, please come with an attitude that how you can solve the public problems. See, even when you have done your Vivek band activities, when you go to the village, don't come with reasons to tell why you could not do anything or why this cannot be done, why that cannot be done. You always look for how it can be done. This is one attitude which is required, whether it is in social service or in public service, or for that matter, even in any work, sphere of work you are doing, please have a positive attitude that is going to help you in a big way. Another very important thing is sustained motivation levels. The biggest problem today, most of the professionals face in every sphere of activity, is how to maintain high energy levels for long periods of time. For this, we have examples of Swami Vivekananda. Even somebody whom you can relate very closely is somebody like Sachin Tendulkar. Why? For 24 long years as a cricketer, he could maintain his energy levels and his dedication was so exemplary that even on the day of his retirement, he could practice for 5 hours before he came out to bat. So this should be a level of sustained motivation which is required. Normally what happens when you start any work, even your Vivek band activities, you will go with lot of enthusiasm. After some point of time, the energy level drops and somehow you lose the motivation, you feel okay, we have done enough or what is there to do. So many things come into the mind. It is very, very important to sustain the energy levels for which you have to draw inspiration from many sources, not just maybe reading a good book, maybe watching a good movie, maybe talking to some good people, maybe doing some help to somebody in some way. It may not look like a social activity, but still it will inspire you to regain your energy to do good work. Then, in all the spheres of activity, you should require to constantly update, innovate your skills and do not become irrelevant in the scheme of things. Because we are living in a fast changing world. Technology is changing so fast that if you don't keep pace with it, you will become very shortly irrelevant. So this is true for most of the organizations, for most of the individuals, and even for some of the social activities which you do, we have to look from where we are, at what stage of technological and economic development we are, and how we have to modulate or change the things to suit the needs of society. Then develop the right skills for every job, because as you keep growing, you need different skill sets. Once you become occupy a managerial position, you require different skill sets than doing a good job. What I have seen in government services, most of the people are good in doing original work. You give them a piece of paper, ask them to do something, they will do a good job. But you give them 10 people and ask them to control all the 10, they become failures. Only 1 or 2 out of 10 people, they are successful in managing a group of people. It is very, very difficult. Even to organize a function like this, it requires some skills. Then, one more thing which I wanted to tell, I was talking about dharma for each thing you need to do. Even if you are righteous, even if you are transparent, you are honest, you are clean, you have done a good job, it still doesn't mean that nothing bad will happen to you. Bad can still happen to you because there are always occupational hazards in any profession. Even in public service, you try to do some good, something can go wrong, you will be criticized, you will be even prosecuted, you will be sent behind the bars, anything can happen. So still one should not lose the motivation to do good work because occupational hazards will always be there. I'll give a very simple example. Take a housewife. Every day she cooks food. When she is cooking food, there are many times which she will be burning her hand by touching some hot thing. That doesn't mean she will stop cooking the next day. She will be continuously cooking for the next day. Similarly, a driver who is driving a vehicle. When you are driving a vehicle, there is every chance, however careful you are, however good you are, you can always meet with even a small accident. That doesn't mean you will stop doing driving. Similarly, a doctor may do a small mistake, somebody might not operate properly, or he may have given a wrong diagnosis or wrong prescription or whatever might have happened. Still, it should not demotivate you and say, since I have not done correctly, I should stop doing it. No, you should continue to do, because only one very important thing which I want to tell all of you, because you are all very young, out of experience I am telling you, there are hundreds of decisions which I take every day in my office. I keep on filing the files. There are hundreds of decisions which I take every day. I can put my hand on my heart and say that all my decisions need not be right. Even with all the best intentions, there may be a few decisions which I might have taken it wrongly. If I say that all my decisions are right, and I should be God. I am not God, I don't have that wisdom. The wisdom God has given me at that given point of time, with my understanding, I would have taken a decision. In the from a future perspective, or from at a later stage, you may find the decision to be slightly wrong, or it might have caused some problem to others. So always be very clear that there will be occupational hazards, you will be doing some mistakes, and the law of nature is such that most of your mistakes get covered up. Unfortunately, once in a while, maybe you might have done, say you have taken 1,000 decisions, 5 decisions are wrong, 4 decisions get covered up. To your bad luck, 1 decision may get highlighted and you may get punished for it. So that is what I call it as occupational hazard. And a lot of government servants I have seen, public servants, they stop taking decisions. Even this culture has spread to even the private sector, and it has spread to most of the organizations. They don't want to take decisions because they are afraid of the result. Okay. The biggest thing as youngsters you have to learn is be decisive. And especially if you want to join government servant, be very, very decisive. Please take decisions, don't hesitate. Something can go wrong, doesn't matter. But still I advise all of you, wherever you are, in whichever position you are, be decisive. Please do take decisions and be prepared for all your actions. If you take 100 decisions, maybe 99 might be correct, 1 may be wrong. That 1 also may get ignored, or sometimes it may get highlighted. And finally, I want to tell you about doing social service. After doing all the hard work for the organization for which you work, for which the salary you get, you may be left with some time. But definitely you have to use it for doing some good, because you have taken so much good from the society. There are a lot of people who are doing good, they are beneficiaries of all that good. So identify yourself with whatever skill sets you are having, to the best extent possible. Think how you can contribute, in what way you can be of relevance to the society and to the people at large. Last but not the least, the most important for all of us is, keep your life very simple. Please balance your professional life and your personal life. If your personal life goes for a toss, you can never be successful in your professional life. There is a beautiful harmony which is required between your professional life, personal life, and even the social service which you do. Keep all these things in mind, and I wish you all the best. Thanks for giving me this opportunity. I thank Sanskriti Foundation. Thank you very much.